Lesson today is taken from Lamentations, the third chapter. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone in silence when it is laid on him. Let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. Let him give his cheek to the one who strikes, and let him be filled with insult. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve the children of men. The word of the Lord. We will read responsively Psalm 30, found on page 585 of your Pew Bible, we will read by whole verse. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up, and have not let my foes rejoice over me.
O Lord, my God, I cry to you for help, and you have healed me.
O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit.
Sing praises to the Lord, O you that sing. You give thanks to his holy name.
For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning.
As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved.
By your favor, O Lord, you made my mountain stand strong. You hid your face, I was dismayed.
To you, O Lord, I cry. To the Lord.
What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell you of your faithfulness? Our second lesson is taken from Corinthians, starting at the 8th chapter. Of the second chapter, 8th verse.
2 Corinthians 8, chapter.
We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And this, not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. Accordingly, we urged Titus that as he had started, so he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in the act of grace also. I say this not as a command, but to prove by the earnestness of others that your love also is genuine. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for the sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich. For I do not mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of fairness, your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may supply your need, that there may be fairness. As it is written, whoever gathered much had nothing left over, and whoever gathered little had no lack. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the fifth chapter.
Glory to you.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, And seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live. And he went with him. A great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years, and who had suffered much under many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but grew worse. She heard the reports about Jesus, and came up behind him in the crowd, and touched his garment. For she said, If I touch even his garment, I will be made well. And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, Who touched my garment? And his disciples said to him, You see the crowd pressing in around you, and yet you say, Who touched me? And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. While he was still speaking, the time came for the ruler's house, some who said, Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any farther? But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, Do not fear, only believe. And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw Jesus, and saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. They laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, Talitha kumi, which means, little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. They were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the biggest lies that is portrayed as being religiously helpful is the phrase, God won't give you more than you can handle. Part of the intent behind this theological snowflake is that no matter what circumstances you face in your life, you are to simply lace up your bootstraps, dig your own way out, because God knows you can handle it. Such fluff feeds off of the independence we've been taught to achieve and persevere and fight for in our lives as Americans. And so indeed, it's easy to buy into this. But that is how the devil works. He crafts things in such a way that they sound right, but in reality lead us away from God. For if God won't give us more than we can handle, then the natural question becomes, well, why do I need God? And if we're asking ourselves that, we have fallen into the pit. In today's readings from Lamentations, and from the Gospel according to Mark, we are met with people who, quite frankly, cannot handle the situations in which they find themselves in. Lamentations is a 5-chapter book outlining the devastation that God's people are experiencing in exile. Israel is suffering for its sins. They are met with the judgment of God carried out through Babylon. And it is under Babylonian rule that the streets where people once walked and played are now filled with remembrances of where loved ones are killed. God's people, once joyful, have become bitter. Women and children are hungry, malnourished. Many are finding comfort, something impossible to grasp. And if all this was not enough, the temple, built, adorned by King Solomon to the wondrous glory of God, has been laid waste, reduced to rubble. The symbolism there cannot be understated. God has abandoned them. So to say to these people, God won't give you more than you can handle, would be nothing more than a slap of the face to their faith. Instead, Jeremiah the prophet calls forth the people of Israel to cling to faith, to remember the steadfast love of the Lord that has been demonstrated time and time again by God's people. In the face of devastation, hardship, pain, sorrow, grief, depression, faith survives. The Lord is good to those who wait for Him, to the soul who seeks Him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. The Lord indeed showed mercy. In the direst of circumstances, people seek out God. They did it in Judaism, God's people searching, seeking Him out. And in the time of Jesus, people sought Him out. They looked to Jesus as one who could help them when no one else was able. We have first Jairus, a layperson. He has given himself to in service to the Lord at the synagogue, seeing that the priest would lead worship and that all would go well. We may think of him as the one always behind the scenes, tending to the needs of worship and making sure all was right. He was the one there every Sabbath greeting you with a smile. He was a fixture, and you noticed when he wasn't there. When Jairus, though, appears in the gospel story, he appears at a time of deep desperation. Fear, worry, a sense of panic had set in over the health of his daughter. With urgency, Jairus throws himself down at the feet of Jesus, literally praying, Lord, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come, lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live. Jairus, Jesus, they begin to travel to Jairus' home. But along the way, they are interrupted. Jesus is interrupted by a woman of great faith, likewise facing her own challenges. A woman who had every reason to doubt. She'd been seen by doctor after doctor for this hemorrhage. that had lasted 12 long years. She was penniless because of the health care that provided her no answers, no cure. All she had was faith. If I but touch even his garments, I will be made well. Notice what she is asking. She's not even asking to look Jesus in the eye. She is actually more happy to just simply touch the fringe of his cloak without even interrupting him, without even bothering him. That's the power of her faith. For she knows that Jesus has that power to bring healing to her. And Jesus confirmed such faith. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease. Is this not a better answer than to tell people to rely upon their own strength at a time when already being overwhelmed? Now, to Jairus, this interruption must have seemed like an eternity for him. And during this time, his worst fear has become realized. Word has come that his daughter had died. In that moment, we don't know what's going through his mind. We can likely guess. But rather, in this news that is being delivered, there is also a temptation being made. Your daughter is dying. Why trouble the teacher any further? And that's the temptation. His friends are offering him theological soda pop that does nothing to quench the thirst. And Jesus speaks in the face of such temptation as he bids Jairus to believe. Continue to keep your faith firm in me, for indeed, as Jesus would say to another person in similar circumstance, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. So even as others mock Jesus at the notion that he might have power over death, as others mock at the notion that Jesus does not know what he is talking about, Jesus takes the girl by the hand. Talitha kumi, little child, arise. Only Jesus can do this. Only Jesus can not only raise the dead, but he himself die and rise again to new life. Only Jesus can and has won over the powers of sin, death, and the devil as they fight to separate us from God, to destroy faith, and lead us thinking that all we have to do is buck up and endure it. Try as the forces of evil might, we are reminded in Romans 8 that nothing, neither death nor life, nor rulers, nor angel, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So as disciples of Jesus, we do a far better job of giving witness to the saving faith in Christ when we invite people to believe and trust in the Lord. We do well to rely on the actual word of Scripture and not our own made-up sayings. For there in the words of Scripture we hear such things as this, that the Good Shepherd leads us through the valley of the shadow of death, not abandoning us, but leading us through. We do well to remember and call to remembrance that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. We do well to rely on the words of Jesus Himself as He bids us to come to Him, to receive Him, my body given for you, my blood shed for you. We do well to remember Jesus as saying to us, go in peace, your faith has made you well. Amen.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, the life of the last. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all people according to their needs. Eternal God, You know the trials we go through and how there are times when we think we cannot go on. But even in our darkest hours, You encourage us to hold on, to be patient, and to wait for Your perfect timing. Help us to put our hope in You, even when we struggle to wait. Lord, in Your mercy, loving God, just like King David, we have made many grievous errors in our lives, against You and against our neighbors. Grant us Your forgiveness, and help us to forgive those who have caused us sorrow and Lord, in Your mercy. Gracious Lord, Christ, You have set us free from the power of sin and death, and raised us to new life in Him. Teach us to treasure the freedoms and independence which we are privileged to enjoy. Help us to use them for the good of all. Lord, in Your mercy. Holy God, touch all who are experiencing any kind of need. Bring healing to the ill. Release those whose hearts and minds are held captive by grief, depression, loneliness, or any other kind of sickness. We especially hold before You Janine, Natasha Peck, J.J. Schmidt, Ken and Marsha Long, Sam Scruple, Bernadine, Joseph, Cleta, Adrian, Russell Jr., Jim, Dolores, Maria, Jane, Dolores, Beth Paxton, Andy Ayers, Eileen, Al, Ron, Dolly, Hank, Michael, Charles, Carl, Tom, Vaughn, Sam, Loretta and George, Kip, Andy and Patrick, Kate, Andy, and Katie, Nisha, Luke, Tanya, George, Robert George, Kathy Johnston, and family. Bring to all freedom of Your life-giving presence and healing mercy. Lord, in Your mercy, we give thanks to You for every member of our congregation, and especially ask Your blessing upon Helen Novak, Roy Jr. and Mary Allinger, James, Sheila, Dylan, and Monique Becerra, and Eric, Kim, Autumn, and Summer Kaplan. Help them grow as disciples of Jesus. Keep us close together in fellowship, in the breaking of bread, in prayer, and in service to others. Lord, in Your mercy, Lord Jesus, keep us steadfast in Your word. Grant the grace upon our mission partners, Nile Lutheran Church and Water Mission, the North American Lutheran Church and our Bishop, John Rodofsky, the Mid-Northeast Mission District and our Dean, Pastor Carl Johnson. Uphold them as they proclaim the good news of Christ Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy, into Your hands, Almighty God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in Your abundant mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us be visit us and return thanks to the Lord with our offering.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious. The Lord look upon you with favor. Give you peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Going to be